signed up, and I'm sure Nemo will throw light on some of them. So the idea is to kind of spread this awareness, and obviously the hope is that by doing some of these talks, we'll be able to attract the more interesting talks at the conference. The conference itself happens on the 7th and 8th of December. So we're hoping once every fortnight to have at least one talk on payments. The next talk we're going to try and host on payments and authentication. But today's talk, thanks to Nemo for coming down. Nemo, who's otherwise known as Agai Rana, is does tech at Razorpay. The idea of today's talk is to understand where payment gateways really stand in the payments ecosystem. We did have a discussion the first time around where we tried to kind of arrive at a matrix. We're hoping today will be a much more concrete story to understand where payment gateways really stand. And now with the launch of UPI, what changes or what, what changes for payment gateways? So I'm not going to speak much now, over to you.
It doesn't work. It's up.
Okay, can I have your slides?
Yes.
Ready?
Yep.
So, I'll give the broad overview of the talk.
Yes.
I want to cover four topics. The first is the history of gateways, how exactly did we reach digital payments, how exactly did we reach the state in India where we have multiple fintech companies, we have a huge boom in e-commerce. And at the same time, you know, when you look at predictions for 2020, we were talking about how 500 billion or 1 trillion is the expected market size in digital payments in India. Second thing I want to talk about is what exactly do payment gateways do in the context of the Indian market. So very often, you know, you think about companies that are doing their own gateways, and some startups are doing its own. A lot of other companies, and if you are a startup in India or if you're starting a company, it becomes very. You may think of a payment gateway as a trivial thing. You know, it's just moving money from place A to place B electronically. But at the end of the day, it comes down to really more complications than that. And I'll get into some of those complications and how they affect us in the Indian market. I'll also get into some of the regulatory challenges, some of the financial challenges, and some of the legal challenges that we face as a company. The next part of the talk will be about challenges and opportunities in the digital payment space in India. What exactly are the pain points that not just customers but businesses are facing today? And what are the opportunities that a growing company can take forward and attack as going in? The final part will be just about UPI. In case you haven't heard, UPI is the brand new payment method in India. Which, you know, this may be about it just a payment method, it's not more than that. And then we'll do it for the years now. And how exactly does it change the landscape in India? How exactly does it affect you as a company or you as a customer? So, so yeah, first of all, the history of payment gateways. In India specifically, this all started somewhere around 2000. You know, this is the era when CCMA and Bell is the primary two companies that first started. CCMA was just started because people wanted to sell things online. So the guy who started it wanted to scare SRE businesses from what I read and referred to. And if you want to sell anything in India online at that time, it wasn't possible at all, especially in terms of if you go and look in terms of international acceptance, it just wasn't there. The first gateway in India was actually built out of the need of the customer, of being the own customer, which is what CCMA was trying to sell saris online internationally, which wasn't possible, and they made a gateway to do it. However, once you know, backtrack to the same thing as product, when you try to launch CCMA as a product in India, it doesn't work because merchants in India didn't want to sell things internationally. Not all of them, the majority wanted to sell things domestically. And B, the fraud issues that come up when international payments is really, really huge, which is why they decided to keep a domestic product which launched across India. The next company they launched in India was PGs. Which you may have heard of, has a huge share in the market. It primarily started out of Bell payments, which is, you know, utilities, you know, phone payments, landlines, electricity, all these things. It worked out really well for them. And today, in 2016, 15 years later, we have a huge gamut of other payment gateways in India. We have PayU, we have Citrus Pay, which is required by PayU. We have Razorpay. Other than us, there are companies like JustPay, there are companies like Customers who are trying to capture a huge share of this market. So when you talk about the market in India itself, the relationship is somewhere between 500 billion to 1 trillion is what we expect to see in the next couple of years. By the way, if I speak too fast at any point, please just raise your hand slightly, I'll notice you and I'll try to go slower. I've been known to speak slow and I apologize. Speak faster. So, now today we have all these different payments gateways in the market, and essentially what each and every one of them is trying to do is capture a majority share of the market. We have Customers, for example, which is trying to capture the long tail of the payment sector in India. With long tail where you have small and medium-sized enterprises trying to come up and try to get the final small versions of the market. Then we have companies like PayU, which are trying to go the hard cost way, get majority of enterprises across and get them online. We ourselves are trying towards the enterprise to the SME side. So each and every payment gateway in the market has its own growth strategy, and that's how the situation currently is. Any questions so far? So yeah, nice point. So for example, I believe I read a report around 2013 which stated that more than 80% of the online payments in India, this 2011, more than 80% of the payments in India were actually just for travel. This is from my lab though. Today, I would assume this has gone down substantially to include a lot of e-commerce, because that is where the market is heading towards. So that's where we stand today. Lots and lots of payment gateways, and how do you use them as a company, and so on. The second thing I want to cover is what exactly does a payment gateway do? I would really like to explain this. What all things does a payment gateway with context to India do? Of course, it moves money, so this is the second round of the talk. A, of course,
can I turn off the flux?
Can I turn off the?
Turn off flux.
It's just gonna be this, like, I don't think you need to do much. So yeah, what exactly does a payment gateway in India do? A, of course, we have payment gateways in India that accepting money. You need to accept money for a customer, move it across to a merchant. That's the basic gist of it, right? It sounds very trivial when you think of it. However, if you're a payment gateway in India, you can't just accept one mode of payment. India is a complicated market. You have people trying to pay, you know, not just via traditional mediums like cards. There are people who also want to, you know, pay via, for example, the wire transfer. Hey, I saw that you have this thing called IMDS transfer, or lots of, especially NGOs and websites who are accepting donations put up their IMDS credentials on Facebook. This is my address code, this is my bank account number. Please transfer money using this. It makes sense for them to do it because customers are ready to pay that amount using IMDS. At the same time, if you are a payment gateway, can that be a payment method for you? Yes. Can you make use of it? Yes. However, how many gateways in India are doing it? We move to other things. We have credit cards, we have debit cards, we have prepaid cards in India. For example, I'm sure some of you have heard of this company called Happy.
Yeah.
I think Hasgeek is the method. So, they, for example, have cards issued by RBL Bank. their co-branded card machine, the RBL, as well as Happy, that a company distributes to its employees, and they can be accepted in multiple places across India. What about accepting those cards? Does it happen differently? We'll get to that. Second thing is, of course, net banking. Net banking, somewhere around 30-40% of almost all online transactions still happen using net banking in India. People are still not comfortable with the idea of credit cards in India, which is where we're looking at a large market compared to, for example, in the US. We have net banking, which is really, really complicated. So, for example, what happens in a net banking transaction is that compared to a credit card or debit card transaction, where you have a single card network taking care of majority of issues. So, for example, even if it's a Punjab National Bank versus an HDFC credit card, it still goes through the exact same route because it's, for example, MasterCard or Visa card and debit card. However, in the case of net banking, it changes entirely. Each and every bank that tries to provide net banking to its customer provides it in a different fashion. And that is where majority of the issues come. So, bank that is trying to provide net banking to you, as I say, HDFC versus HDFC, entirely different. And it brings up a whole host of issues about how to refund, how exactly the chargebacks work in the
front. So, for all these state matters that are particular payment gateway supports, what are the costs for the payment gateway to be, like, from the banks? Like, what is the most profitable?
The most profitable, of course, is always debit cards. It's not profitable. The profitable is the least cost. The reason for this is because RBI essentially has issued a guideline and a circular to all banks in India, which says that you can cap debit card prices at 0.65-0.75%, which means they're not allowed to charge any more than that. They're of course not going to charge any lower than that. So all of them are exactly charging the same price. So that's
I'm surprised that you're calling net banking a big problem. Even the credit cards have that three-factor authentication,
yes.
Right, where everything is specific to that particular bank.
Yes.
And has dependency on the SMEs.
Yes.
Isn't that as bad as?
Net banking still has exactly the same second factor requirements. Some of the banks, for example, they'll even make it worse. For example, if you try and make a transaction using PNB, it'll ask you for a transaction password, which is different from a login password, along with a second factor, which is sent over to SMEs. So now you have three passwords to enter to complete your transaction.
This complication also creates opportunities for companies like just to make a for an experience on the
yes. Third part, however, is the thing that nobody's ever in our proper world anywhere else, wallets. Wallets as a payment method in India are a really unique phenomenon. I mean, compared to, for example, other markets, you won't, there's this thing called SafePay by American Express, which is technically a wallet, but it's nowhere used. It's not, it doesn't have as much adoption anywhere in the world. For example, if you consider Paytm or MobiKwik or PaySap or Ola Money, which has its own wallet, or Flipkart, which is going to be launching its own wallet, all of these different wallets in India are essentially going to do the same thing, to just capture more and more money from the customers, keep it on them, so that they can make payment processing easier for the customers. However, for us, as a payment gateway indicator, it ends up being just another different method of payment that we can offer to a customer. So yeah, that's the easy part of it, you know, moving money from point A to point B. What other things does a payment gateway do? Any guesses? Come on.
Fraud, was it?
Refunds, of course. So refunds are also another complicated issue. The way refunds usually happen is something called same source refund, which means that where you got the money from is where you get the money back. So for example, if you try to pay via net banking, we have to ensure that, you know, the payment gets routed exactly the same way from where it was initiated. If you made a payment by credit card, it has to become a credit card refund, and so on. Our wallet refunds will of course be treated differently. Then of course comes the issues of fraud and chargebacks. So how many of you have ever issued a chargeback?
What's a talent?
Wow. Okay. See? Okay. So this is something that comes up from the credit card industry across the world. What happens is, if you try to pay for a credit card, if you pay via a credit card, it's not essentially your money that you're paying. It's not actually directly from your bank. It's the bank's money that the bank has decided to give to you at an interest, which is given out to your merchant. However, let's say if the merchant doesn't deliver on the goods that they promised, or the goods are under promised, as in there was late delivery, the shipment got scratched, or the product wasn't good enough, you can issue a chargeback, which is essentially you asking the bank, hey, I did not get this good, or it wasn't up to the mark, which is why I like to file a chargeback. A chargeback is essentially you telling the bank, I want my money back. And in this case, the money wasn't yours to begin with. So if it was the bank's money, right? Which means that the bank is far more likely to fight for this money in order to get it back. So you can file a chargeback. So the way the chargeback chain routes up, essentially you asking your bank, which will try to reach the payment processor, which in this case would be something like Razorpay. We would go back and ask the merchant, hey, why exactly did this not happen? What happened wrong with the shipment? So, and then the chain would work back from the merchant giving us the delivery proofs, going back to the bank saying, wait, we have the delivery proofs, you have accepted the shipment, you have your signature. And then the chargeback is figured out essentially in the terms of, you know, the dispute is cancelled or refunded. Okay.
So who decides?
The arbitrator is essentially the bank at this point. So your bank is essentially fighting for its own money. The bank gets the authority.
Does that happen here?
Yes. If you have a credit card in India, you can file chargebacks. If you have a debit card in India, you can file chargebacks, but the bank is not likely to file.
So which bank are we talking about? Is it the person?
This is the issuer bank. So in terms of paying, if we talk about two banks, there's an issuer bank, there's an acquiring bank. Issuer bank is the bank whose card you own or whose bank account you are running with. The acquiring bank is the one that is actually processing the money on your behalf.
So is that the one you still merchant?
That is the one, not that is not after necessarily the one that actually uses. Can I write somewhere? Yes.
Last time we did a matrix,
so there's an issuer bank, which is, let's say, there's a customer trying to pay via credit card. I own my bank. This is the bank account, bank A. However, this is the merchant. Merchant doesn't know anything. Merchant is tied up with a payment gateway service. The payment gateway talks to something called an acquiring bank. So not all banks in India actually perform this duty as an acquirer, because it's a cost-heavy business. You have to invest a lot in technology. So there are probably around 5-10 banks in India that are actually doing it properly. It doesn't make economic sense for all of the efficient smaller banks in India to actually do this as a business. So now you're an acquiring bank, which will essentially route the transaction to different places. So for example, the customer is trying to pay, so you get the card details. The card details are passed on to the acquiring bank, which could be, for example, HDFC, ICICI, Access, most of the major large banks in India, which will talk to Visa, MasterCard, figure out where the transaction needs to go. They will internally let us know, hey, this thing has a second factor authentication on it, in which case we need to run the transaction properly. But remember that the issuer card is the one that decides where the second factor goes.
So the acquiring bank is decided by the payment gateway?
Yes.
So you use a bunch of them, right?
Yes.
Like if I do one transaction, you might use bank one.
Yes.
If I use another, you might use bank.
Yes.
Sometimes you have an option. Let's say IRCTC, you can choose, okay, I want to use HDFC or Access or ICICI, you can choose.
It depends on the payment gateway.
Yeah, yeah.
So we, for example, if a payment fails, we can decide to use a different payment gateway. Chargebacks. However, you know, a major cause of chargebacks is not just because a customer wanted a refund. A major cause of chargebacks is also because of fraud. So for example, if your credit card was stolen and somebody else made a fake payment, or somebody else decided to, you know, buy a game on Steam, what can you as a customer do? You file a chargeback. However, this would technically come under the definition of fraud. So at which point payment gateways need to invest in this thing to block a fraudulent charge from going through. So that's one of the major issues that payment gateway faces, especially not so much in India, because of course because of second factor and the RBI regulations. But fraud is still, you know, there are different ways of doing fraud in India compared to. So Indians are very jugadu, as of course all of you know. So I'm sure some of you read the story of how Uber drivers are doing, not Uber drivers, but Uber drivers are trying to do things. So similarly, people are. I'll have to wait. That will be
yeah. After all, we'll have another discussion.
Yes. But yeah, for example, I talked a bit about payment fraud in India and how it happens. Payment fraud in India, usually in international markets, what you see is customer side fraud, which essentially, you know, you get a stored credit card, you make a payment using that, and you get the goods to yourself, or you try to move money from different place to a different place, you can launder money for it, and so on. In India, however, what you see is merchant side fraud, which is there's a merchant entity which will sign up for a payment gateway, and now what they try to do is charge the customer for the same money, except at their processing end, and get the money. So, for example, what you've seen is a customer's I had a really nice card phone conversation I would like to play, which is actually a person getting a phone call from fraudster, telling them, "Hey, your credit card has been approved for an upgrade. Can you give me the last 6 digits? Can you tell me the first 4 digits? And just, can you give me the entire card number? Can you tell me the flip it over and tell me the CV number? Hey, have you just gotten an OTP from a bank? This needs to be approved in my system. Can you tell me the OTP next, please?"
Consumers are not that kind.
There are. They are. That's the problem.
I see a bank has a dread at the back.
Right.
He asked her to take a photo and he took a photo and sent it.
Yeah, what's that for fraud?
Okay.
So fraud is another major issue in India. It's not as big compared to other markets that I mentioned earlier. But yeah, we do face fraud even on a merchant scale. Where a merchant can decide to submit fake documents and then use it to rob money for itself. So we have to undergo a KYC process, not just because of fraud, but also because of payment gateways. What other things does the payment gateway do?
Can you just say normal procedure for the chargeback credit card?
You call a bank on a phone number. Okay, that's pretty much it. Some banks may or may not have a banking thing or whatever. Okay, so far we've seen how you make payments. What happens exactly when the money moves from a customer to a bank to a payment gateway? However, there are also issues regarding how money moves from payment gateway to merchant instead. So, you know, this is actually what technically called a settlement or a reimbursement to a merchant for goods that they have sold in the last 3 days, last 5 days. How exactly does this happen? So, let's assume you as a customer, if you are running a payment gateway, how do you move money to 10,000 odd or 100,000 odd bank accounts within a single day? Okay, the use case essentially, I have some people's money as a payment gateway and I want to give it to them on a regular automating basis, right?
Merchants.
Yeah, I want to pay merchants because they have delivered the goods, let's say, and I want to pay them. How would you automatically pay so many people?
So, like batch process.
Yeah, so it essentially comes down to that. However, it's not easy, so you have to talk to different banks, they'll offer you different ways to do it. So there are automated systems actually built by different banks which you need to talk to. And another thing that you need is essentially something called a mobile account. So that is their current account, their saving account, which everyone learned back in school what the difference is. However, there's something called a mobile account where you don't own the money, but you hold the money. It's kind of an extra one. So for example, we as Razorpay run multiple local accounts where we can poke the money to and then move the money forward to a person from there automatically, which means if each and every place where we own this local account, let's say HDFC or Kotak or some other bank, we need to go and talk to them and figure out, hey, how can we automatically move money to it because we need to have a urgent requirement to them. Automatic movement of money, not just to you because that is taken care of the bank, but you also need a way to forward the money ahead to the merchant themselves. What else does a gateway do other than just payments? You also need to think of user experience. So at the end of the day, it's not worth anything if you are not able to actually prosecute and give a good enough user experience to your customers. So it's not just backend engineering, which is what we're talking about so far. It's also a lot of talent where you need to make sure that a customer is able to, you know, fill the card details and pay. For example, if you go and one of the my major pain points for most gateways in India is why do they ask me to tell them my whether I have a credit card or a debit card? Okay, it doesn't change in any manner. I'm still entering a card number. I'm still entering a CVV and my expiry details. Why do you need to ask me about whether I have a credit card or a debit card? Okay, so far, any questions? Yes, which makes sense. Yes, well, that's, which makes sense, except not everyone in the industry is doing it. It does make a difference actually. So what happens is, as I mentioned earlier, the debit card rates are lowest in the market, but rates for credit cards will usually over somewhere around 2%. They can be lower or higher depending on which bank you are on, whether it's a credit card, whether it's a Visa card, whether it's
Yes,
to the end user it doesn't matter. The bank is the sponsor is the gateway to figure these things.
No, but in if the chargeback and all those things, that's my money against that. Debit card is money.
Yes. But no.
Debit card is
yes, but it doesn't matter as in if the payment gateway can figure out the information on its own, it shouldn't need to ask you.
Is there a traditional thing of why it started this way? For example, it's the numbers would overlap. Like right now, you can do patterns like credit cards and Visa and Master, all of all have their own patterns, right? Traditionally, it did not.
Is how this, that? However, no. Even if you detect whether it's a Visa card or credit card, debit card, you can't. It's really hard to figure out whether it's a credit card or debit card. You can figure out whether it's a Visa card or Master card. Whether it's a Visa HDFC card versus a Visa PNB card, for example. But it's hard to figure out because PNB is giving out these cards later.
Alright. And it's important for the gateway to know this one?
Not always. Okay. So far we've discussed what exactly does a payment gateway do. Challenges and opportunities. This is where I want to talk a bit about regulation in the industry. Okay, we'll take around 15 minutes and then we'll wait for discussions. So challenges and opportunities. The first and foremost is of course second factor. This has been the biggest help in terms of fighting fraud as well as the biggest problem in terms of how it is operated in India. So, for example, the second factor has held back the rise of recurring payments in India for a long time. Right? There are all these SaaS companies. If you're running a SaaS business in India, you can't charge Indian customers easily, which is a huge pain point for most Indian companies. So, as a result of it, you're seeing the startup ecosystem in India cater towards SaaS companies that are entirely US focused, or entirely focusing on the international market rather than the Indian market. They are only accepting international credit cards. So, how many what percentage of customers in India will actually have a?
Actually, Stripe does that. Stripe uses
debit
cards. Stripe uses debit cards.
It is accepting Indian Visa cards.
Yeah, by default. So, there's an RBI regulation again that comes into the picture, which essentially says all cards in India are by all cards are by default domestic unless the customer has asked for it. So that makes a huge. So ultimately, the answer comes down somewhere around 2-3% of all cards in India are being accepted internationally, which means unless you have recurring billing, which is really, really hard to get in India. Cool. So yeah, of course, second factor. What other? No. So I'll explain what's the difference. A net banking in India is traditionally essentially a net payment that you're making from your account. All it gives you is a pre-filled form of, you know, a payment source and a sink, which is my money to somebody else's place. So, once you initiate a NEFT transfer, it's done. There's no way you can, you know, put a NEFT transfer on a standing instruction, for example. Is there a difference?
Your bank's account, I have a different account. Two?
Two? What case?
Another account. So, you choose. Like it's not a merchant, it's my.
It's a standing instruction thing. Which is.
How do you do it for
a merchant if you're
So it's only allowed, SIs are only allowed on basically utility bill payments,
and backpack processes.
So we actually explored this when we.
So bill payments are not
used. No, the utility bills, electricity bill, water bill, all of those things. But it's being opened up, it's getting opened up.
It's getting opened up. For example, you have seen Hotstar, right?
Yep.
Hotstar in India is actually doing Bitcoin billing.
In India.
On
India.
So the RBI regulations are slightly murky at this point.
Not really. So basically the first payment is supposed to be two factor auth. So what happens is they make you do a 5 rupee transaction, they're able to put it in two factor. But after that they can charge your cards. So it's allowed, but only on credit cards.
Only credit cards are still weak.
We tried doing that like last month, and HDFC was kind of willing enough to tie up with us, but they did want our customers to fill out a credit card, which we couldn't do online.
That would be Natch, I think.
I don't know.
Natch.
Yes. Natch, so all the trading companies use that. Right? Send you a form, you're supposed to sign it, allows you to put your maximum amount, schedule, and everything. That is paper driven. That is the problem. That's why it cannot be used on e-commerce. But that's changing with the recurring billing thing.
There's also this thing called Keynote, which is actually the same thing over two things. But yeah, so.
Okay.
Shashank, I thought he was in the other way. Thanks for joining. Okay.
Net banking to net transfer.
Yes.
Net only happens in a time window in the day.
Yes.
Whereas net banking can happen immediately. How do you explain that?
So net banking is not scheduled on the NPCA front. Scheduled on the back
transfer.
So the difference is that if you go and submit a paperwork to issue a net transfer in your bank, the bank branch will essentially run an hourly job and say, hey, I've got a bunch of net transfers to make at this time. But however, when the bank itself is doing it, they can issue a net transfer whenever they want.
But also, if there's a small fee that you do net banking, if you're paying a merchant to net banking,
there's no fee because merchant is being charged for it.
For merchant bears the
yes.
It's not time. Banking is a monopoly. Each bank has its own charges and it's higher than their costs.
Yeah. Is it true to say that most Indian customers think net banking, like psychology, is more secure?
Yes.
Yes. And that's why we are currently at 7.8%. I should have one more. Actually, there are a lot of issues. For example, the card themselves, there's actually card number that they leak, your bank. However, at the same time, the friend of mine was actually saying, if my card leaks, I still can file a chargeback. If my net banking credentials leak, you essentially have no recourse because the net transfer is not refundable in any manner. Let's go on to UPI unless somebody else has other questions.
If your card leaks, before you report it, whatever happens, some sort of transaction happens. That is also, as per the question, can be.
It depends on the bank. If you can convince your bank that, you know, I lost my card at 12 when I called you at 6 in the morning, it's up to the bank. Okay, one thing I have a
online e-commerce. It's online e-commerce with proof of
delivery. Yeah. No.
Whatever. Using your
debit
card. Yeah. You still charge money.
Yes. No, it depends on where the fraud state used, right? From PDA or
something like that.
Okay, once I bought something from Reliance Digital, and the QMS statement that money got refunded. I didn't ask for a chargeback, the money got refunded. And then.
The cards? Where did you buy it?
I bought it from Nemo.
And it shipped to you?
It's not shipped, I bought it often at a Reliance Digital store. And I got the money back. And. No, it's not cashback. I got my money back to my account. I paid through debit card. And then six months later,
they debited their money again.
Sometimes the face oscillation doesn't find
two
entries in the ledger.
Yeah, but it reversed twice, is what you said.
That happens better than that.
6 months later, he got charged again for that.
It's possible if the mistakes are bad.
Yeah,
it's only possible if
it's
bad.
It's probably somebody did bad data into an Excel sheet and settlements.
There's no way, especially for a debit card, I don't think there's a way that, you know, Reliance could have charged you after filing a refund again. So it's probably an issue on the back side. Okay. Yeah, let's move to UPI. So,
yes. Can I have a last question? If I'm a merchant,
yes.
Or let's say I'm setting a website where I want to accept payments.
Yes.
How do I choose a processing gateway?
Okay, that's I'll go
okay,
to
maybe offline.
No, we just keep the question. So UPI, what does UPI change? How many of you have tried out UPI so far? That's still good enough. 6-7 people have actually installed an application. How many of you have heard of UPI?
Yes.
Okay, almost everyone. How many of you understand what UPI is actually doing? Oh my god, that's quite a lot. I'm out of a job, dude. Pop quiz. Okay, pop quiz and UPI. Who runs UPI?
NPCI.
Who owns NPCI?
Thanks.
NPCI is a private corporation owned by 12 to 15 banks in India. With all of them have equal stake and no dividends. Which is essentially they are part of the decision making process. What else? For those who don't know UPI, okay, yeah. So UPI essentially stands for Unified Payment Interface. It's a really nice experiment, so far an experiment into how digital payments can evolve in India and become far, far better compared to what it currently is. So what it tries to do is link the right on the back of the mobile revolution in India, which is lots and lot of customers in India getting smartphones. If people are getting smartphones, how can we use smartphones to make them pay online? You know, because debit cards, NPCI and RBI have tried out other things. There have been lots and lots of schemes for, you know, distributing UPI cards. Our customers who receive UPI cards do not pay online. You've seen that in the past. Customers in India do not get credit cards. People are still preferring cash and delivery. So how do we solve this problem? Let's try to write on the smartphone data and make sure that every customer with a smartphone is able to pay online by using smartphones.
Android smartphone.
No, it's still tricky because NPCI, this should be out within 6 months is what they had said. Let's see how long that takes. But so far, it is just limited to Android smartphones. The original docs mention all three, which is Android, iOS, and Windows. However, seeing how Windows Phone has performed in the last, since they announced it, I don't think it will ever launch on Windows, but yeah.
What's on Windows Phone?
We have, so what UPI allows essentially is to link your smartphone to your app. And once you have that map, you know, this equating to your bank account. This essentially means a mobile number. You can do lots of interesting things on top of this. Assuming that, you know, the majority of Indian adults own a smartphone, but majority of them do not. Anyone gets this? Okay. Once you have this mapping, you can do lots of cool things. For example, if two people want to transfer money to each other, if they know their phone numbers, can we just move money between them? Yes, we can. So that is essentially one of the first things that UPI brings to you. It brings P2P payments, which hasn't ever been approached as a problem in India. So you have
P2P, but not going to the bank.
So at the end of the day, okay, I'll talk a bit about UPI. So UPI is actually a bank transfer between point A to point B, which rides on smartphones. So in order to authorize a payment, you need a smartphone. However, at the end of the day, it's essentially an IMPS transfer. So what happens internally is, you know, if I'm transferring money from my bank account to somebody else's bank account, it will essentially internally make an IMPS transfer from my bank account to your bank account. However, if I, you know, try to transfer money from my bank account to somebody else's mobile number, it will essentially figure out, hey, who owns this mobile? Does this person have a bank account? Yes, let's move money there. So that's how UPI internally translates things. But leaving that aside, it allows for P2P payments. So now you can easily, for example, let's say if you want to transfer money to a bank account right now, how do you do that?
Log into
your banking thing, add a beneficiary, wait 30 minutes, hope it works, cross your fingers and then send it over. But yeah. Or you do it by a medium.
So Paytm has the wallet thing. It's just a different Paytm wallet app which you can use to transfer money. However, there are inherent limitations with that.
So what is the client app for the
bank apps? So the way it works is each and every bank will launch its own different banking application which you can use to sign up for UPI. But UPI will additionally give you, other than your mobile number as a login, essentially something called a VPA, which is a virtual payment address. So once you have that virtual payment address, it could be something like Nemo at ICICI. Once I have that, people can pay to it and I can pay from it. And the nice, beautiful thing about this concept is that the other party who I'm paying to doesn't get any other details than my VPA. So, for example, in case of credit cards, if you want to charge a credit card, you need to know the credit card number. Right? In this case, what happens is I give my VPA and it appears to the other side, the merchant, that somebody who is Nemo at ICICI has paid me. They don't have enough information about me to figure out to actually charge other transactions. If you have my card details, you can do things like that. But in this case, not.
One number is only linked to one PP or one to many.
So you can have one to many mappings, but they are not currently.
Like now, one to
many PP. So it's not like in all apps.
No, on phone pay, I have three PP.
Yeah, okay. Can you see? Yes.
That's more of a phone verification.
You're allowed to have
a phone pay. It's a UPI consumer application.
But essentially, there are multiple banks which have launched their own UPI apps. Phone pay is another UPI app that is launched in partnership with Yes Bank. They can use to do the same thing as you transfer money from you to the other person. So A, it brings you P2B apps. What other things does UPI bring to the market?
How they are charging the curve from transferring to my friend the money? What is the amount of money that they charge?
It's free currently. So if you're the
So basically, government wants to promote digital economy and everything, right? So what the strategy is that P2M, when you're paying to a merchant, that's going to be paid by the merchant. But peer-to-peer is going to be free because they want to promote you paying via UPI.
Okay, so
and
yes.
So the banks are bearing the charges.
Who will be bearing the charges?
Banks.
Okay.
So that's how they're hoping to incentivize it. What other things that you get? It brings you faster and easier payments. So, for example, currently what happens in a second factor is you have to traditionally wait for an OTP. It's not across all banks, but the traditional model so far has been to wait for an OTP before you can go through the entire second factor. In this case, however, the second factor is actually an template, which you can decide to regenerate, however, it remains the same for each and every payment for your bank account.
So, you
generate it once. You generate it once. You submit it once. And then you can reuse it. Which means each and every payment comes in like a 4-digit number or 6-digit number and the payment goes through. Which is easier than paying transfer.
But then somebody needs proper computer on that.
They would also need your phone to do it.
So your phone is done.
But then it's
same like that,
yes.
Your
phone is becoming your authentication mechanism, right? Your phone becomes your authentication mechanism.
You need to have
the second factor is still your MPIN. So don't tell your MPIN to people, of course.
Okay, don't store your MPIN.
Like your ATM credit card.
Oh, yes.
Is there upgrading my credit card?
Come
again. Is there upgrading my credit card?
Yes, of course, you have to.
Yes, of course.
That's the option.
But yeah, keep your MPIN to yourself. The second thing, yeah. It brings you a far more easier way of paying. So what happens, this is what we discussed so far in the P2P place, where I can type to somebody else's PPI, I can type to somebody else's phone number, and initiate a payment with them, and they get the money, because they know who that phone account has back. What you can also do is P2M payments, which essentially the merchant asking you for money. So that is a nice second thing that UPI brings to the table, which is collect requests. So you can, as a merchant, you can ask money from other entities.
The merchant just
advertise
their
BPA. No. If you advertise your BPA, others will have to pay you and they'll have to set the amount. What you instead want to do is ask for money and say, hey, I bought a ticket to Hasgeek. You're trying to buy a ticket to Hasgeek. I want you to pay me exactly 3,000 bucks, exactly 5,000 bucks. So what happens as a result of when you issue a collect request is that the other customer will get a notification on the phone, they type their 4 digits on the phone and it goes through. Yes,
So for the merchants, the big advantage is they are no more storing card numbers, right?
Then almost your card numbers
and card numbers storing safely is a
huge. No hardware.
Yeah, no extra hardware. You're relying on the customer to do the hardware things, right? You have to just issue a collect request and you get the money.
So how does a merchant return payment to
so
anything like M2P?
No, so that's yes, it would technically be like the way I talked about refunds earlier, right? So there are two kinds of refunds. You have same source refunds, which is you want to move the money to the exact same channel that it came through. In the case of, for example, net banking, when you issue a refund, the bank may internally recognize it as a refund, but it's just another NEFT transaction from you to the end customer. Okay, similarly, in the case of UPI, what you essentially, since I only get the EB of the customer, right? Only say, hey, Nemo and ICICI have paid $5,000 for a conference ticket. Now I want to reimburse that money back to Nemo and ICICI. So the bank needs to provide a way to, you know, move money back to Nemo and ICICI, just as better than. So essentially, pay request that pay move out money.
What's payment instruments support?
What?
Payment instruments support.
What payment instrument?
Yeah, debit card, credit card.
No, so
exactly.
So in order to get a UPI handle, you need to have a debit card, you need to have a bank account, and you need to have a phone number that is linked to your bank account. So once you, if you try registering on the app itself, it'll ask you for, you know, your debit card details to verify that you actually own this debit card, which will be internally verified to used to verify that yes, you own this bank account. It'll also verify your phone number at the same time to make sure that the phone that you're using is the same phone number that you registered on your bank account. And then it'll issue you a UPI handle, which you can use to make transactions.
So can I also pay on credit?
Can you also pay on credit? No. UPI is a bank transfer mechanism, as I mentioned earlier, which means you can just do bank transfers from point A to point B. So there's a credit associated.
And bank accounts to wallet?
No. So this is the key point. UPI doesn't double IMBS, so you can't really have wallet transactions. However, with payment banks, this may change, but that may take time. Okay.
So here the merchant account can be a current account, and customer's account can be a SBI. Is that
yes.
How it works?
Yes. So yeah, P2M payments where you want to pay merchants and the merchant can decide to pay you back. Those are primary two things that UPI does, and it does them nicely. What are the advantages of, you know, moving to UPI for a merchant? If you're starting in India and you want to do something in the B2B space, UPI is the thing for UPI now. You want to move money from point A to point B, and it gives you a far more easier way to do it than ever before. Otherwise, let's say if you were trying to build something like Venmo in India 2 years back, how would you build it? How many of you know what Venmo is? Okay, Venmo is essentially
peer-to-peer
payments for trivial things that you have had in your friends.
Peer-to-peer.
Okay. People have been using it for very interesting rates. Fraudsters in the US have also jumped on the bandwagon. But the core of the market is actually peer-to-peer payments that you can pay out to your friends and say, hey, $5 for this. If you wanted to build something like this in India, however, you really have no choice. You really have absolutely no way till UPI to actually build something like this.
Chilean was trying to do something.
Yes.
They had to partner with multiple
banks.
Actually,
what they were doing was actually like UPI, which
yeah.
required an NPIN, I had to go to the IBS,
yes.
but then it required them to go into
every
single bank.
Single bank
so, what US. Happened is NPCI went to every single bank, made a problem, and now you
banks
started to work.
Yes. So, yeah, Chilean was trying these things, and it didn't work out very well. So, now we have UPI for us.
So, what distinguishes P2P and P2M?
What distinguishes P2P and P2M? Your relationship with the bank. If you have downloaded the app with the customer, you essentially get P2P payments. However, if you have a current account, you won't get an AES. If you have a current account, you need to get a merchant account.
You can't download a consumer app
and
link it to a current account or to a loaded account also.
And
a business cannot take money into a sales account. Maybe.
So if I want to test out, try out the UPI API. Is there anywhere as a dev can do it?
No. Come to that.
So how do we start building things around UPI?
So you talk to banks. So the way NPCI is structured so far, we are trying to fix this, is that NPCI essentially launched UPI as a gateway API, which is accessible to the banks. Okay? If you need access to the API, you go talk to the banks.
So the
banks are actually sponsoring your access to UPI.
So which bank should I talk
to? Anyone
should
like. So any of the banks
online. Right,
SBI is the biggest one, which are not still on UPI.
IPNB launched, but PHP not. Access and
Access,
Access,
Yes Bank, TCB, all of these are.
Karnataka Bank also.
There are a lot of. It's in 10, 12 banks as well.
Will one bank give it out to two companies?
Yes. There's no, as I said, it's also similar to how issue acquiring banks could, you know, they're helping you capture the entire card market. Similar to that, if you talk to one bank and get an UPI access, you essentially get access to the entire UPI. Or whatever API is the bank is like.
Should I have any preference on picking a bank? Like Access, Yes Bank, and Karnataka Bank are giving me UPI.
Figure out your use cases. What exactly is it that you're trying to do? What kind of APIs do you need?
Like, would there be difference?
Yes. So UPI actually internally has lots and lots of APIs, and the banks are deciding to expose very limited subset of them.
So is there some endpoint, or who do I talk to? Like, let's say I want to talk to Yes Bank today. So, what at Yes Bank should I send?
There is a digital payments vertical nearly every single bank. That would be the right body. But it's not that easy to track them down, and they probably will not. Very honestly.
Depending on how big you are.
Yeah.
You need a lot of leverage.
So, yeah.
Sounds like their digital banking account is in Mumbai. So, they are the ones who are.
Yes, most of these things happen in Mumbai. So, yeah, we have like how many meetings with banks in a week?
It's like you open up to the business.
Maybe. So, we are looking to do things around the sandboxing. So,
NPCI has an entire sandbox, but the problem is to get access to the sandbox, you have to do a lot of paperwork. And they are still picky about who they're going to give the sandbox to. So that's still a challenge. But there are ways around it. Probably companies, some companies can come out with an identical API set that you can build against.
So I was looking at the eKYC APIs, and they have certain things that you need to have. Like, you need to guarantee a lakh transactions in the first 3 months. You need to be have this kind of paid up capital and so on. So does UPI have similar requirements?
Even those regulations, the thing that they're talking about, so eKYC also is given to PSPs, these are all PSPs.
Yeah.
And that PSP is put in the limitation because they don't want to be giving out everyone, so it's put in the limitation. But government will not put it by.
So which bank is the friendliest? They're friendly.
The quick answer to this is right now every single bank on UPI is very deaf-friendly because everybody wants to have some startup build something which will help them gain merchants or customers. So right now most banks you'll find are very friendly.
However, deaf-friendly is not the same as machine-friendly.
Yeah.
So even though, you know, they may be able to give you developer resources,
I
at the same
the
time,
XMLs, yeah.
Yeah, at the same time, no, the XML is just one part of it. The problem is because the banks are exposing their own set of APIs which may not be as reliable as the absolute APIs.
Okay.
So it depends on what quality of APIs that you're getting from them.
So the UPI API docs will not work. I'll have to work with bank API docs.
Yes. So that's the medium that banks are currently working on.
When are recurring payments coming?
Recurring payments are planned in UPI V2, which is still in draft phase. So you may get to hear about the draft being finalized towards the end of this year, maybe, and then we can.
What's going to happen is that anybody can apply to be a PSP. So you can apply that your company wants to be a PSP which wants direct access to NPCI, there will be rules on that. But right now the condition is only banks can be PSPs. So it's very limited, it's going to open up a bit, but never in such a way that a random developer can go to NPCI's site, get keys and start.
Payments bank will have access.
Yeah, they need a dedicated lease line to the data centers and so on for being a PSP.
It does require your servers to be in India. It does require your you do get encryption keys and decryption keys and all those things. Set up a proper calendar being even there. But it doesn't require a dedicated lease line from them.
So in the eKYC, right? To be a KSA, you need to have a dedicated lease line to.
That is, I think it makes more sense because, yeah, there are more sensitive marketing centers.
So I don't know if this is relevant to the topic, but can we just recap so that we can get a video graph of you also?
Okay.
So we can recap, take a bunch of questions, and obviously there's a lot of food and drinks downstairs, so we can take all the conversation. Then Nemo is going to be here for the rest of the evening.
Yes.
Till tomorrow morning.
Don't get to kidnap me. Yeah. So yeah, we started off with the history of payment gateways in India. How exactly is payment gateways making short the Indian market? What exactly is it that payment gateways in India are trying to do? Not just process money in India, but also trying to capture a market share between the 500 billion related goals that we are seeing expected to see by 2020. So the idea is about making sure that each and every one of the customer who's coming up online and trying to pay, and the e-commerce boom that we are seeing, and the mobile boom that we are seeing, all these can correlate to the digital payments boom that we expect. What does a payment gateway do? It's not just money movement, it's also fraud, it's also multiple payment, handling of multiple payment methods, it's also handling chargebacks, it's also handling funds. So all of these are typically complex problems that can have their own entire companies built. For example, there are companies that entirely just do fraud detection. And a payment gateway is expected to do all of these together. Challenges and opportunities. We talked a bit about regulations in India. We talked about offsetting factors. It's still murky in India. Some companies are getting through it. We always had standing instructions in India, but they were always limited to bill payments, utility payments, and so on. However, what will happen, for example, if RBI decides to put a magical bullet to the button and say, hey, two-factor is now disabled across X transactions, where X could be a condition that they put. What all can change to just an item? Finally, we talked a bit about UPI. What UPI brings to the table, it brings us payment payments. It brings us a really, really nice payment experience on the mobile phones. However, there's a huge condition applied thing, which is you need a smartphone, you need a bank account, and you need to have anti transfers enabled. That's the thing, you need to have a debit card as well, which is actually a precondition for almost getting a bank account open anywhere in India. But yeah, in our UPI, which brings us to the end payments, you can also ask customers for your money and say, hey, can you pay me the money for this particular thing that you just bought, and so on. That is where we stand today. I'm closing for now. We can have a discussion.
Yes, so Nemo, thank you so much for talking today, and thank you for closing. So you might want to talk about the 50 mark.
Thank you.
So, unless you have very, very pressing questions, I think we should let Nemo go. And obviously, all of you are welcome to continue the conversation downstairs. Can we close the evening? Thank you.